Who are you?
I'm Dr. Jodi Rowley, and I'm an amphibian biologist at the Australian Museum.
What's with these fanged tadpoles? First of all, what are they, and how big are they?
Okay, the fanged tadpoles belong to the species Rhacophorus vampyrus, otherwise known as the vampire tree frog. They're small tadpoles. I've actually got some in a jar here. So only a couple of centimetres long and really skinny. They live in small tree holes in the forest in southern Vietnam, and they have fangs, which is a lot of the hype has been about. They're not actually fangs, but they are black curved hooks that stick out of their mouth, which you can see in this image here.
That leads on to the big question which everyone is asking. Do they suck blood? Tell us the answer is yes.
I can't tell you the answer's no 100%, but it's pretty unlikely that they do suck blood. It's probably related somehow to the fact that they live in such small bodies of water in the tree. So maybe they eat something strange or use them for hooking onto the tree or something like that.
Going on this whole vampire myth here, they suck blood, they fly. Are they afraid of the sunlight or anything like this that we know of?
Well, they are nocturnal, so they are only active at night, so they are hiding during the day. So you only ever see them out at night, and that's when we go out at night with headlamps on looking for them. The flying thing, it's quite apt that that group of frogs that they belong to are called flying frogs. It's not because they flap and fly off of trees, but they do have this webbing between their hands and toes, and they do glide. They're also called parachuting frogs, so basically they can jump from branch to branch without having to go to the ground.
One big question is, how did you actually find this frog?
Well, we tend to look for cool new species of frogs in mountains, and so I spend a lot of my time climbing up mountains with my colleagues from Vietnam. So this was in the southern highlands of Vietnam, so we can get as I fly there first, obviously, then we get a car or motorbikes as far as we can go, and then it's on foot, basically climbing mountains. This site was a little easier than most, but it usually does involve carrying everything we need for a couple of weeks on our backs and climbing up a mountain, and there's usually no paths.
So are you saying that the life of a scientist is not as glamorous as it's made out to be?
I don't know, that's pretty exciting. I mean, this part where I sit in a chair in the office looking down a microscope and on a computer is probably, I guess it is more glamorous than the alternative, which is covered in leeches in the forest.
So, and then you're climbing through the mountains, and how did you find this amazing frog?
Well, we don't know what we're looking for. So a lot of people have said, you know, were you looking for this specific frog? Well, we don't know what's there. We've got no idea. So all we do is we choose usually a wet time of year. In these kind of places, there's usually not a dry time of year, to be honest with you. So it's all cloud, forest, all wet. Everything's covered in fungus, including you. And we just put headlamps on and go and look and see what you can see. And you can hear frogs calling, obviously, and so then you can focus in on those ones and see what it is. And you can also see the eyeballs of the frogs shining back at you if you wear a headlamp on. So we spend a lot of time sort of looking in the trees and seeing if we see any frog eyeballs staring back at us.
Well, thanks for your time.
Thank you very much.